So my name is Emma Chickles, and I am a third-year graduate student at MIT, but currently I'm at a conference in beautiful Hawaii. I've been working with Tansu Dalen, who is starting at WashU this fall as a professor, as well as Kevin Burdge, who you know, and is a chatGPT enthusiast like myself. I have a lot that I want to show you, so let's jump into it. So to set the stage for what we've been using ChatGPT for, the Transiting Exoplanet Survey Satellite was launched in 2018 and has since been monitoring millions of stars for variations in brightness, which we know is associated with a wide range of physics, and some examples of which I put on the bottom here. This is, of course, too large a volume of data for a human to inspect by eye. And moreover, TESS is not the first or last all-sky survey that will produce enormous amounts of data, like the Roman Space Telescope, which will be launched in 2027, and it will monitor hundreds of millions of stars. So as astronomy enters this era of big data, we must start to consider new methods to help us cope with these vast amounts of data. Furthermore, we're also curious about phenomena that we don't understand or haven't observed before. So this raises the question, like, how do we search for something that we haven't yet discovered? This brings us to unsupervised machine learning. In particular, we've been thinking about autoencoders, which is a type of neural network, which I pictured here on the right, and allows us to extract meaningful features and discover patterns within the data without requiring the data to be explicitly labeled beforehand. The idea is that with these autoencoder learned features, we can identify hidden patterns in the data, group data into clusters, and possibly even detect unusual or anomalous data points that deviate significantly from the majority of the data. So this is an idea that my collaborators and I have been thinking about for some time now, but I am a novice at machine learning. And all the machine learning and learning about TensorFlow and all the machine learning algorithms available is quite daunting and time consuming, especially when the outcome is less certain that we will learn new physics with this machine learning approach as compared to more developed approaches in the field. So this is where ChatGPT comes in as a huge time saver. Luckily, TensorFlow is a very popular machine learning library, so there is a large amount of documentation, tutorials, research papers, and various articles using and talking about TensorFlow. So one of the most helpful features for me has been to use ChatGPT to write accurate code. So here I'm using asking ChatGPT to write a one-dimensional convolutional variational autoencoder. And previously in the same chat, I had used ChatGPT to help me first pre-process all my light curves. So it already has some awareness of my data set here. And for me, variational autoencoders is something that I've tried unsuccessfully before. Online, there are many tutorials for two-dimensional images, but I'm working with one-dimensional time series, which poses an extra challenge. And you can see that this code, it's very readable, and for those who are familiar with TensorFlow, seems reasonable. At first, we define an encoder model, we define a decoder, and then at the bottleneck, we're applying some reparameterization trick that is applying Gaussianity to those extracted features. And while this code ran, and I was able to print that variational autoencoder summary at the bottom here, I did encounter a disconnection during training, which I will talk about in a second. But the point is here that because TensorFlow has been widely used, or ChatGPT is able to write accurate code for it. This also brings a word of caution, so that while ChatGPT can write code for other Python libraries, I have noticed its proficiency and accuracy is definitely higher for widely used and well-represented libraries. So for example, when I've asked ChatGPT to write code using AstroPy, which is a widely used package in astronomy, but not elsewhere, I've noticed that it will give me functions that don't exist. But TensorFlow is one of the most popular libraries for machine learning. So it's encountered a wide, greater variety of TensorFlow-related examples during training compared to more niche libraries. So it is able to help me with my machine learning projects. Here I put some tips and tricks, or my personal preferences for debugging. And while this might not be the flashiest of applications for ChatGPT, this is honestly what I use ChatGPT the most for. And what I wanted to highlight here is that ChatGPT can take inputs as long as 4,096 words, not even characters, 4,096 words. So since it can handle large inputs, I will generally give it the entire function that I'm working on. And then after I copy and run and modify the code ChatGPT has given me, I will then give the entire function again. So we're working on the same up-to-date version. I will say, though, that it does take some time for ChatGPT to generate a long response, which can be annoying if you have a particularly long function and it's only modifying one line. But in which case, I'll just specify to ChatGPT to just give me the line that needs to be modified. And another tip I have is to ask it to create a test script with random data to test its own code. And that's been a very quick way I've been able to make use of the code that it has given me. I'm going to just quickly show some examples of how it's helped me debug. So as I mentioned before, I had an issue with a disconnection in my autoencoder. And this could have taken forever to debug, especially as someone who is not too familiar with TensorFlow. But ChatGPT was able to interpret this error message and fix this bug pretty instantly. And on this next slide, I just have an example of me also giving outputs of my code in the same format that my code spit it out as, with the dashes and indents, and it had no problem reading it and finding the error. And after this correction, I was able to run my autoencoder model. So for example, autoencoders will take in the light curves, compress it to a low dimensional representation, and then try to reconstruct the light curve from the representation. As you can see on the left, we have some of the original light curves, or rather period folded light curves, and the reconstructions. And now what I'm trying to work on is to better handle the class imbalance in my data. And TensorFlow has given me, ChatGPT has given me plenty of ideas already to go for. Luckily, because of its training, it has a great understanding of TensorFlow's concepts, functionalities, and best practices. So I will definitely take its ideas into consideration and augment our autoencoder or data in the future. The other aspect of ChatGPT I wanted to touch on is visualization. So this is in MoMA, not something that I made, where unsupervised learning, a GAN instead of an autoencoder, was used to learn a low dimensional 1024 dimensional embedding of artworks at MoMA with the goal of generating new art forms. This was really inspiring to me, and I wanted to make a similar visualization to that low dimensional representation on the right. And indeed, I asked ChatGPT to make a three-dimensional movie that both rotates and zooms of a T-SNE, which is a representation of the autoencoder learned latent space. And this is the code that it gave me. And then this was the result of that, which I think I'm very happy with. And on the left, I also show some requests I gave it additionally as I iterated with ChatGPT to improve this video. So for example, I made sure that the colors that it selected for my clusters were all okay on a black background, and I was able to just quickly pull up the matplotlib color map that would be visible on a black background, which could have taken me a long time to look for in the matplotlib documentation. I'm coming up on my time here, but I just wanted to show some other visualizations that I've been using ChatGPT for. So for example, I was able to very quickly make this T-SNE plot where each point is sized and colored to the anomaly score of each of the light curves in my data set. And in addition, I wanted to make a similar plot as that one MoMA video I showed you, showing the original artworks and where that falls in the learned latent space. So I asked ChatGPT to make that for me as well in a two-dimensional version. And with that, I'll leave it here. But ChatGPT has been super helpful because of its knowledge about TensorFlow and Matplotlib, and has been a huge time-saving tool so that I can spend less time coding and more time interpreting plots and thinking about how we can improve the algorithms instead.
Yeah. All right. Thanks so much, Emma. So any questions for Emma? Feel free to come up to the microphones.
Hi, Dev. Have you done any comparison between testing 3.5 and GPT-4, and what do you see?
I have not tested GPT-4. I have not paid for it yet. Maybe if you can convince Kevin to get it for me, then I'll have an answer for you.
All right, Kevin.
Yeah, I've bought GPT-4. We can do that during the demo session because you can flip between the two. I found 4 is much better for coding.
Thanks, Emma, for a nice talk. So far, you've sort of demonstrated that ChatGPT can be very good at, you know, generating code for autoencoders and things like that. In terms of the future of astronomical data analysis, do you think there's a path so that if we sort of train large language models with enough astronomical software, we can do more general tasks, like, for example, generate a reduction pipeline for this particular data set, rather than just giving you some generic architecture for some machine learning algorithms? Thanks.
Yeah. So there is a group at Harvard that is working on fine-tuning language models on ADS, which is our astronomical database with all of our astronomy papers. I hope with that we can really be able to, already ChatGPT seems to have good knowledge about existing astronomy textbooks, but also there are times when it gives me inaccurate ideas. I definitely am hopeful that will greatly improve our ability to use machine learning with astronomy.